On the night he was betrayed, Jesus and his disciples halted in an olive grove called Gethsemane. Then going apart with Peter, James, and John, he left them on watch and continued a little further alone. There he fell on his face in anguished prayer. Soon he returned to the three on watch and found them sleeping.
Rousing them, he asked Peter, "Could you not watch with me for just 1 hour? Watch and pray that you are not put to the test, for the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again Jesus went apart in troubled prayer, and again he returned to find the disciples sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. A third time Jesus withdrew to pray, and a third time he found the disciples sleeping. Then Jesus said, "Sleep on and finish your rest. Now is the time for the Son of Man to be delivered into the hands of sinners. Here comes my betrayer."
Jesus had not finished speaking before Judas, one of his own disciples, arrived with a group of Roman soldiers and other armed men from the temple. Now the betrayer had arranged with the authorities for a sign and had said, "The man whom I kiss is the one you want."
In accord with his arrangement, Judas went directly to Jesus and cried out, "Greetings, Master!" And then he gave him the kiss. Jesus responded, "Judas, would you betray the Son of Man with a kiss?"
Those who had seized Jesus brought him to Caiaphas, whom the Romans had made a high priest. Peter followed at a distance as far as the courtyard. There he sat with the attendants and warmed himself by the fire. The high priest had gathered his whole council, and they began to arrange the case against Jesus, which they would present to Pontius Pilate, the governor.
The charge was that Jesus claimed to be the king of the Jews, and they brought in many false witnesses, but to no avail. Finally, two came forward and testified, "We heard this man say, 'I will tear down this temple made with hands, and within 3 days build another not made with hands.'"
Yet, even these witnesses were unable to agree on their testimony.
When the morning arrived, all of the chief priests, along with the other Roman collaborators, bound Jesus and delivered him over to Pontius Pilate, the imperial Roman governor.
"We found this man perverting our nation," they said. "He was forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor and proclaiming himself anointed king."
So the governor asked, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus answered, "You say so."
The chief priests were accusing him of many things. Therefore, Pilate again spoke to Jesus. "Have you no answer to give?" he asked. "Look at how many accusations they are making."
But Jesus astonished Pilate by remaining silent.
His accusers brought many false charges against Jesus, but he spoke not a word in his own defense. "Crucify him," they shouted. Pilate washed his hands to show the decision was not his own, but he did not dare to side publicly with Jesus. Instead, he was willing to placate the people. So Jesus was condemned to death.
Pilate said, "I find no fault with this man." But when the crowd grew loud, he grew silent. "I wash my hands. You deal with him." Pilate had the knowledge and the power to stand and say no to the world that sought to crush the Lord of life. He didn't use either.
How many times do I have the knowledge and the power to say no and stay silent? How many times do I participate by my silence in the suffering of others? Who will pay because I do not say no?
Thank you.
Dearest Jesus, you hear my silence and still you love me.
Because you say no to the world says no to you. By the power of your Holy Spirit, give me the courage to stand and say no with you. Help me to take up my cross and follow you.
Jesus was scourged. The whips cut his back until he was shredded and bathed in his blood. A crown of thorns was set upon his head in mockery. Then they returned his robe to him and brought him to the cross on which he was to die. Jesus embraced the cross, resting it painfully on the smarting wounds on his back.
This cross has been thousands of years in the making. Its weight grows greater each time I look for someone to blame for the pain in my world. Each time I refuse to show mercy, I add an ounce to the burden Jesus carries for me. This is the cross he carries, our habit of turning our brokenness into the cross of blame and vengeance.
When have I said, well, he certainly deserved that, or it's only fair, look what the
Dearest Jesus, each step you take today is made harder by our hardness of heart.
You carry his weight so that no one else ever will, not even me. By the power of your Holy Spirit, please give me the desire and the strength to forgive, to lighten your word.
Thank you.
Jesus had willingly embraced the cross, but his physical body was weak from lack of sleep, from the pressures of arrest and trial, and from torture and beating. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak, Jesus said. Jesus said yes, but his body hesitated and he fell to his knees, determining to rise again, even in his weakness.
Jesus falls to his knees, and the people laugh at him and mock him. They hand over their individuality so they can be part of the group, a group united around despising a helpless outcast.
How many times, Lord, have I sacrificed my individuality to be part of the group? How many times have I tried to belong by joining in with their disparaging of someone?
Gracious God, you sent Jesus to embrace outcasts and give strength to the weak.
By the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord, grant me the integrity to stand apart from the crowd and to extend the hand of grace and fellowship.
Jesus meets his mother. As Jesus again shouldered the cross and bore its burden, he glanced ahead and saw his mother. He could not stop to talk, to explain, to gather her in his arms and comfort her. All his energy was being soaked into that cross. Who are my mother and brothers? Those who do will of my Father? Not my will, Father, but yours.
We draw back, revolted by such suffering. But your mother will not permit it. She withstands the blows of insult and sorrow to be present for you along the way. She alone remains to give you courage, to remind us that you are someone's child, just like we are.
How many times, Lord, have we watched another suffer, but from a safe distance? How many times have you looked out through the eyes of another for comfort, but were unable to find it?
Dearest Jesus, your mother stood with you to give you strength and to hold up your humanity in the face of our temptation to look away.
By the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to see the humanity of those whom the world wants to erase, and give us courage to stand with them, to strengthen them, and to claim them as brother or sister.
Mm-hmm.
horse pinned by the soldiers. Only later did he recognize the privilege in shouldering the burden of the one who carried the suffering of the world. He was forced to carry the cross, part of the labor Jesus. Simon himself, a stranger, an outcast, often misunderstood, perhaps identified with him and felt Jesus' gratitude. Amid the pity Simon felt for him, he felt a burning compassion flowing back to him from Jesus, a burning, life-changing love. Simon carried the cross of Christ.
Am I a disciple of the gentle Jesus, the loving teacher, who lifted the burdens of those bowed low by pain and sorrow? The road of life is crowded with those who carry crosses, those who have been flogged and abused by old age, poverty, or alcohol, by a poor education, drugs, or crime.
When I see them pass my way, do I hide, plain and detached spectator, or do I freely step forward to lift up their cross?
Here's Jesus. Simon stood in for us when you couldn't go forward.
Come and meet the Lord of Christ, and that of others, and follow you, Lord Jesus. For by my living, I share in the liberation of the world.
Please join me in your brown black hymnals, Make Me a Servant, 2176. We will sing it twice.
She reaches out to touch his face, and he leans his head into her hands within her reach.
You have been beaten so badly that you are marred beyond human semblance. As you walk along, you are almost unrecognizable. It is so much easier to be revolted when we cannot see your face. But this woman will not permit that. She steps forward and wipes away the blood and sweat, showing all of us your human face.
How many times have we missed your humanity, Jesus? How many times has it been easier to deal with your suffering because
Jesus, your suffering is the suffering of a true human being, suffering we want to avoid seeing.
Your face revealed the face of last, the least, and the lost. By the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to see what this woman reveals. Help us to see your humanity in all the suffering around us.
The pain, the exhaustion, the love drives the Lord on. Again he falls beneath the weight. In bitter resolution and fatigue, Jesus again drives himself up against the cross, carries it on towards the fateful hill of death. Thy will be done.
We have all experienced falling beneath burdens too heavy for us. Sometimes we are drained of the strength, determination, or love we need.
Like Jesus, we fall. Physically, emotionally, spiritually, we buckle under the weight of our crosses. Jesus invites me to show myself compassion for the times I have fallen.
The compassion of Christ grants us the grace to have compassion for ourselves.
May this compassion for ourselves free us from secretly delighting in the downfall of others.
As Jesus continued, painfully stumbling along the road to Calvary, a group of women joined themselves to the procession, wailing in the manner normally considered appropriate for a funeral procession. But Jesus told them instead to cry out to God for themselves and their own children.
Weep not for me, but for yourselves and for your children. The women of Jerusalem want to weep for you as though your fate were unrelated to theirs. as though the violence that you suffered did not own them as well. You turn their sympathy back on them. Remind them that your faith is their faith too.
How many times have we contemplated your cross, Lord, and wanted to cry for you? How many times have we wanted to weep because of your pain and not because of our sin? How often have we blinded ourselves to our complicity with injustice by feeling sorry only for the victims?
Dearest Jesus, we want to be changed. Not only to feel sorry.
We know that you love us too much to leave us wallowing in pity. By the power of your Holy Spirit, open our eyes to the ways that we benefit from injustice so that we might weep for ourselves and for our children.
At the place of death, the King of Life is stripped of his clothes. Naked he came into the world, naked he is taken from the world. He was a crying, helpless, dependent baby. Now, vulnerable, exposed, his heart, his life, his body, all bared before the world. He will be hung up to be mocked. His very nakedness is a parable, a sacrament, a picture of the Father's hurting heart exposed in love to us.
Physical humiliation isn't enough. Spitting isn't enough. Whipping isn't enough. Crucifixion isn't enough. There is need to shame you. I need to strip away from you any shred of human dignity.
How many times have we branded someone with a scarlet letter? Drunk, convict, weakling. How many times have we labeled our brother or sister so as to set them apart, reduce them to nothing by using shame?
Dearest Jesus, as you stand there, stripped before the crowd, your divine dignity shines forth.
By the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to see the dignity that you have, that every child of God has, a dignity that neither we nor anyone else can take away.
The journey was at an end. Jesus was quickly thrown backward with his shoulders against the wood. The soldier felt for the depression at the front of the wrist. He drove a heavy square wrought iron nail through the wrist and deep into the wood. Quickly he moved to the other side and repeated the action, being careful not to pull the arms too tightly. The title, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews, was nailed into place and the crossbar lifted into position. The left foot was pressed backward against the right foot, with both feet extended, toes down. A nail was driven through the arch of each, leaving the knees moderately flexed. Jesus is now crucified.
As Jesus slowly sagged down with more weight on the nails in his wrist, excruciating, fiery pain shot along the fingers and up the arms to explode in the brain. As he pushed himself upward to avoid this stretching torment, he placed his full weight on the nail through his feet. Again, there was searing agony as the nail tore through the nerves. As the arms fatigued, a great wave of cramps swept over the muscles, knotting them in deep, relentless, throbbing pain. Then Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A sponge full of sour wine on a branch was held up to his mouth, and he drank it.
Jesus could now feel the chill of death creeping through his tissues, and with a loud voice he cried, "It is finished." His mission of atonement had been completed. Finally, he could allow his body to die. With one last surge of strength, he once again pressed his torn feet against the nail, straightened his legs, took a deeper breath, and uttered his seventh and last cry, "Father, unto thy hands I commit my spirit."
A while later, a soldier took a long spear and pierced it into the side of the dead man to his heart. The watery fluid of blood that flowed out showed us he had literally died of a broken heart, not the usual crucifixion death of suffocation.
The friends of Jesus were allowed to remove his holy body, and for a moment, his mother held him again upon her lap, cradled in her arms. "Let him sleep now. It is finished."
Thank you.
Jesus, named Joseph of Arimathea, took the body of Jesus and wrapped it in a linen cloth and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever been laid. Joseph rolled a large stone over the entrance and went away.
First Peter, the gospel proclaims that Jesus Christ was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. In the spirit, Jesus descends into the prison house of death, proclaiming liberation to the captives. Christ plunders the grave and sets the captives free. The psalmist says, "Where can I go from your spirit? For where can I flee from your presence?
If I lie in the grave, you are there. If I take the wings of the dawn and dwell at the sea's furthest end,
Christian wrote this song to honor Jesus' victory over the power of sin and death. In it, Christ speaks, and he says, I have stretched out my hands and offered myself to the Lord. Stretching out on the wood, I have opened the gates that were bolted. I have shattered the bars of iron. Hell saw me and was vanquished. Death let me depart, and many came with me. I was gall and vinegar to it. I descended to the depths of hell. Death could not bear my face. I made of the dead an assembly of the living. I spoke to them with living lips so that my words should not be in vain. The dead ran to me. They cried out, take pity on us, Son of God. Deliver us out of the darkness that fetters us. Open the gate for us that we may go out with you. We see that death has no hold on you. Deliver us also, for you are our Savior. And Christ said, I heard their voices, and I traced my name on their heads. Now they are free. They belong to me. Behold, I proclaim liberty to the captives. I have opened the gates that were bolted. I have shattered the bars of iron, and the gate has become red hot. It is melted at my presence, and no more shall be shut, for I am the gate of all beings. I went to free the prisoners. Now they belong to me, because I abandon no one. Amen. Living Lord. Amen.
Amen.